top 10 private bee schools in India.
Our focus is on cutting edge domain knowledge and benchmarking with world-class businesses.
BinTech, excellence with values.
I am thrilled by this opportunity of spending the next few minutes interacting with you and sharing some of my thoughts, with the hope that they may be a catalyst for you to think about the purpose of the journey that you are about to undertake. There is no doubt that India is on the cusp of a momentous period, making its own and world history glorious. Today, India is a land of young persons bursting with energy and wanting to use its technical and economic clout to defy the global economic cycle and propel herself on the path of economic growth in an otherwise bleak global economic scenario. We have come a long way from the period when our Hindu rate of growth did not allow us to think big and to be satisfied with rickety cars and scooters, long waiting lists for telephones, cooking gas, and a banking system that saw clients as a nuisance instead of lifeline of business. We have come a long way from adverse labor relations and food dependency. We have moved on from being satisfied with getting our pair of Levi's jeans from cousins and uncles who were coming from abroad. Today, the smart mobile phone, the internet, the glitzy mall, flashing cars, and the latest fashion are at our doorsteps and have entered our everyday life. The young in this country today have the kind of physical and material options and alternatives which were inconceivable just two decades ago. Students who have passed out of institutions of higher learning in India are today making a mark in the world of business, finance, and computers. The Indian youth today have role models in the form of Sundar Pichai and Satya Nadella. I am sure that from amongst those present here, the new generation of world leaders will emerge and bring pride and glory to our country. I have started this talk by making reference to the journey that you are about to undertake from now on and the purpose of the journey. I have already renounced all the privileges and ideas that he as a prince had inherited and decided to wander in the jungle in search of truth. He found Nirvana under a banyan tree and then preached to the world that material accumulation can never be the source of peace and happiness. India is the land where Ashoka is venerated not so much for the battles he won, but for the thoughts that overpowered him after he won the war at Kalinga and how he reprimanded himself for having caused human suffering. He spent the rest of his life making amends and trying to spread peace and prosperity to his subjects. Gandhiji became a Mahatma and moved the Indian subcontinent to wage a war of non-violence against the British, not because of his arrogance, but his extreme humility and steadfast belief that the means are as important as the end. It was a moral courage of one man that made millions of our countrymen face bullets of the British in Jallianwala Bagh, the lathis of the British during the salt satyagraha, and torture of the jails in which Gandhiji himself and many other freedom fighters were lodged, repeatedly in the hope that the human spirit would be overpowered. It needs to be recognized that it was the belief and inspiration derived from a cultural heritage going back to thousands of years that gave India the courage to adopt a constitution that was remarkable and full of romanticism for a country that had just come out of a demoralizing, damaging, and disgusting phase of mass killing during the partition and experienced human displacement of the kind that had never been seen before by man. And yet to promise each of our citizens, irrespective of caste, creed, equality before the law, and to ensure the rule of law as the basic dharma of our nation was a huge leap of faith. A country limping back to sanity had the moral courage, conviction, and capacity to walk away from all the rancor, ill will, bias, and trauma. This faith is India's ability to rise above and see beyond her immediate sorrows and pains, and strive to achieve a unique place in the comity of nations as a proud democracy. nurtured by and based on the values of morality and sense of equity that are recounted in the Upanishads, the Vedas, the Ramayana, the Mahabharata, the writings and thoughts of Kabir, Mira, Amir Khusro, and the humanism of Vivekananda, Tagore, and the rock-solid faith in the goodness of man, exemplified by Gandhiji himself. This rich tradition of thought, in the absence of a better ideological tool, can be described as dharma, the moral and ethical basis of and guiding principle for the existence and functioning of the state. Each one of us present here has the proud privilege of being the inheritor of this great ideological and ethical tradition. Unknowingly and without notice, each child born and raised in this country is exposed to the social and cultural nuances and ideas that form the Indian conscience. It is these ideas and ethical values that provide India, despite the poverty of its millions, the moral courage and universal acceptance in the world. World leaders, whether it is Martin Luther King or Nelson Mandela, and leaders of contemporary era, have readily and publicly acknowledged the power and relevance of the ideas and values that India stands for. And what India stands for is best recounted in the words of Rabindranath Tagore, who famously said, "Where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, where the world is not broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls, where the clear stream of reason has not lost itself and giving back to society are two powerful ideas which have agitated all great minds of our times, and sincere pursuit of these noble ideas has created several of the most respected institutions of academic, scientific and cultural excellence in the world. Whenever and wherever these high ethical values have gained wide currency, societies have made remarkable transformation." I had earlier alluded to the concept of dharma in the context of the state. I believe that parallelly and simultaneously, each citizen of this country has a responsibility which is equally his dharma as a citizen. Each one of us need to recall that India has been a melting pot of ideas and culture, religions and ideologies over the century. Our subcontinent has the unique distinction of being the only place where each of the four great religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianity and Islam, have at different times been the religion of the rulers. The Aghoris have survived the centuries along with the Sufi, the Sanatan Dharma and the different strands of Hinduism, Buddhism and Jainism. Intellectual and ideological freedom have had social acceptance, and from that has emerged a cosmopolitanism that is uniquely Indian. We need to nurture this core tenet of Indian nationhood, because if we do not, then not only would India lose its moral and ideological strength internationally, but it would also leave itself vulnerable to the kind of civil strife that will seriously dent our effort for social and economic betterment. Cosmopolitanism, with its notions of patience, tolerance and acceptance of cultural diversity, is how global markets are defined. Studies at Harvard University have demonstrated deep interconnection between political stability and economic growth through a study conducted over 113 countries. Social cohesion determines the quality of institutions and is essential for generating the confidence and patience needed for reforms. It is said that the foundation stones for balanced success for any individual or society are honesty, character, integrity, faith, and a sense of loyalty. And these core values are not alien to us here in India. We need only to remind ourselves of them time and again. In the end, I am reminded of the memorable discourse given by our respected former President Dr. APJ Kalam in Hyderabad, where he queried as to who will change our so-called dysfunctional system. He said that for most Indians, it means everybody else other than him. It could be neighbors, other communities, other households or the government, but surely not you or me. He lamented that we lock ourselves along without family into safe cocoons and wait endlessly for a Mr. Clean to come along and work miracles for us with a magic wand. If not, we leave our country and run away. Dr. Kalam had a piece of advice for us all Indians. Let us do what India needs from us. Let us all unite, therefore, to fulfill this dream and with sincerity, diligence and energy at our disposal. I wish you all Godspeed in the journey you are embarking. Be positive, because as an old Chinese saying goes, keep a green tree in your heart, the singing bird will surely come. Jai Hind, and thank you.